So now we finish the last value, right? Tattva Jnanartha Darshanam. Did we finish that? Namu, you were there. Nirmala was
yes,
there.
Yes,
we finished, no? Okay. So the last value, which is the 20th value, which is the 19th value, so we will read the book. So we'll read the book and then I will explain. What is the value? Adhyatma Jnana Nitya. So who wants to read it? Namo, you want to read?
Adhyatma Jnana Nityatva. The 19th value, in the order told by Lord Krishna to Arjuna, is discussed as the final value for the sake of more logical analysis. The previously discussed value, Tattva Jnanartha Darshana, a value for not losing sight of the knowledge of truth as one's primary goal, is an attitude which, for its fulfillment, requires the gain of appropriate knowledge. How does one gain this appropriate knowledge? The knowledge of truth, Tattva Jnana, which is also the same as the knowledge of self, Atma Jnana. Knowledge is not gained by sitting under a Bodhi tree. Sitting quietly under a Bodhi tree may be fine for some other things. Perhaps a reflective person sitting under a tree for some time may figure out certain things about the world and its mysteries. But knowledge will not come to that person simply because he sits quietly. For any knowledge to be discovered, there must be a valid, effective, and an appropriate means available to know whatever that one seeks to know. Adhyatma Jnana Nityatva deals with a valid, effective, and appropriate means for gaining self-knowledge. Atma Jnana, which alone fulfills the value previously discussed, Tattva Jnanartha Darshana, a desire for liberation which has matured into acquiring, into Tattva, the truth. Adhyatma means centered on Atman, self, and Jnana is knowledge. Adhyatma Jnana is the knowledge for which the subject matter is Atman, oneself. Nityatva indicates constancy. Adhyatma Jnana Nityatva is constancy in knowledge centered on the self. Where can one find the teaching for which the subject matter is oneself, Atman? Not in the usual disciplines of learning, such as in mathematics, physics, or chemistry, or in anatomy, physiology, or psychology. Self-knowledge is the subject matter of a traditional teaching called Upanishad or Vedanta, or any name equivalent to these names. The scriptures at the end of the Vedas, where this teaching is found, are also called by the name of the teaching Upanishad. Thus, Adhyatma Jnana, the self-knowledge, indicates the teaching and the books containing the teaching, whose subject matter is the truth of oneself, of the world, and of the Lord, are called Upanishads. In fact, the very word Upanishad etymologically means Adhyatma Jnana.
Okay, let's stop it here. What is this para? What are these paras saying? What are they trying to convey? He's taking two values together. Tattva Jnanartha Darshanam and Adhyatma Jnana Nitya.
What is he saying?
Seems easy book, but it's not that easy as it seems. It becomes difficult, no?
The end is not
difficult. The end is difficult. The last two is difficult, right? Anybody? Just try it, because then it's important, you know, that you at least try to decipher a little bit of what he's talking about. Try it, then of course I'll explain.
Can you put the two values together?
Salad.
This is the 20th value.
This is the, actually, in the verse, it is the 19th value. But Swamiji has taken it as the last value.
Okay.
Because what he is saying is, that way logically it flows better. Okay. So, we saw, last time, we saw Tattva Jnanartha Darshanam. And today is Adhyatma Jnana Nityatva. So now what he is doing is, he is making a logical connection between them. So, Tattva Jnana Darshanam values lies the whole logic of my Vedanta. These two are very critical to understand because they give you the unique place of Vedanta of what it will be doing. So Tattva Jnana Darshana is a value where it kind of made us see the fact that what am I really searching for in life? So that means, why should I even be interested in this knowledge of Vedanta? It's not a philosophical curiosity, it's not an intellectual curiosity, it has got directly something to do with what I'm searching for, right? So this is what this value is, and that is, so there is what we call Purushartha Nishchaya. Purushartha Nishchaya means you need to, it's not just some inquiry, intellectually abstract inquiry, oh let me look into the truth of things and all that. What am I looking for? So what are we looking for is final fulfillment, satisfaction, you know, freeing ourselves from sense of inadequacy, lack. This is our search. Behind all our pursuits, this is what any human being is actually looking for. Now, this everybody is looking for, but where they are looking for is a question, right? So that means we engage in the world and we expect this from it. So how do we engage in the world? Through artha, dharma, and kama. That's all we know. And this is what everybody else does. What is artha? We are searching for different forms of security, different forms of pleasures. And some of us, we also recognize the importance of ethics in pursuing these. So what we are doing is, through these three pursuits, what we are actually looking for is, these pursuits are not for themselves, they are for this end. What is the end? I want fulfillment, I want satisfaction, and I want to free myself from sense of inadequacy, and I want to free myself from lack. And this is all everybody knows to do. Now, so this is why Swamiji used to always say that through security, I'm not searching for security's self. I want to be free from being insecure, inadequate, through that. Okay? So how do we search for security? Through money, power,
relationships.
Relationships. Relationships, very much. Absolutely. Relationships. So this is what we do. Pleasures. What do we do? Holidays, sports. We have so many spas, so many different things. And dharma. Dharma is what? Trying to live an ethical life. Now, what this value is to ask myself, more and more and more of this, does it get me this? At one point, you have to ask, if it is capable of giving you this, you don't need any other pursuit in life because this is what you are really interested in. So if not today, but tomorrow, suppose these things are able to give you what you are searching for, then here only you keep searching. So at some point, you have to decide whether today or tomorrow or 100 years from now, these pursuits can get me here. And can they? And why not? Suppose you say yes, then you have to give me the answer. Yes, they are able to fulfill me totally. Or suppose you say no, that they are not, then you also have to give me the reason why they are not. Right? So you have to do an analysis, not just kind of say, okay, now these things either will or will not. So, how would you go about looking at the capacity of these three pursuits to get you here?
Cannot give fulfillment.
Excellent. So, Okay, now Nirmala's answer is right, that these, no matter how much you have more and more and more, it will not fulfill you totally, and then you have to give me reasons why.
Also, it may be temporary, gives you fulfillment but not sustain.
Excellent. So what you want is a lasting,
yes,
let's qualify this, you don't want just temporary freedom, what you want is a lasting freedom. And what Nirmala is saying is, this will give you some, but it will not give you
permanent.
Why not? He does an analysis here. Why? I mean, it's easy to make a statement, this will not give you freedom, but you need to logically understand, why is it that it is not able to give you the freedom that you are searching for?
Because just like in work, you aspire, you're ambitious, so in here you plateau at a certain point. So you want more, right? You want to be a more ethical person, you want to do more dharma, you want to do. So if you, unless you just find that calm, then you achieve a different level of, I mean, it's only because you want more.
Okay.
No, so because they're all externally related also.
Okay, so what? I mean, yeah, they're externally related, but maybe there can be a solution to my feeling.
But you don't feel complete from it, in spite of having.
Okay.
You see, there's still something more. I mean, it doesn't satisfy you enough.
He's going off and on. He's not consistent.
Okay. So, Swamiji, in this book, he gives an example. He says, the way things is, because you're looking for lasting fulfillment, the way all of them are organized is that they are constantly changing. Right? It's not like whether they're good or bad. There is no value judgment. It's just how the world is. So how the world is, that the objects themselves are constantly changing. What it means is any object is within time and space. And the time and space means suppose it can go away, right? So that they are limited and they are changing all the time. Today you have a given object, there is no guarantee that tomorrow you will have it. So then otherwise what happens is, it's interesting how over a period of time I have seen, you know. So I went last week to somebody's home and I was like, this is a home or a palace. But when she started talking about, the thing, she says, we have lost 90% of our wealth. So, when you see the lifestyle, when you see how they live, and it seems they are like some crazy amount of money. But in one's lifetime, one sees these cycles. And it may seem as though, it may be far for me, but she says, few years ago, you cannot imagine how much wealth we had. And it's like 90% decline. And now, what she was saying is, we have to fight for bankruptcy. So that is.
So they turn to Vedanta.
Sorry? Yeah, then she, the wife is exactly, absolutely.
But she may not have known it for money to begin with. Because in 3 years, to 10% of your net worth, you've been so badly leveraged that it wasn't your wealth.
See, that's the thing. We are so badly leveraged. I think this is the problem. You have a successful business. Bank gives you a lot of loan, then you go on expanding and you lose track at some point.
No, sir,
right?
Not based on
ethics. Sorry? It could be. So that means the objects, even though it may seem as though it will remain with us forever, the objects are designed in a way. This is just an example that they keep changing. Now, you and your preferences also
change.
If you yourself look at your own life and you ask, okay, what did I really desire when I was a kid, when I was a teenager, when I was an adult, when I was 30 years old, and when I'm now 50 years old. Your desire, you are not sitting and deliberately thinking, okay, now I'm over this desire and I'm now going to pursue this desire. Your desires are naturally changing, okay? Now, your preferences are changing. The objects themselves are changing, and the third thing is your moods are changing. means is that suppose, so within all these constantly changing things, you are looking for permanent satisfaction. Is it possible? Why? Because the object that you had yesterday, there is no guarantee that you will have it today. You, whether you will still value it or not itself is in question. The third thing is, even if you have it, your mood can change. So I can give you an example. Just today, for example, right? Suppose you had planned a vacation, some amazing vacation in the summer to some exotic place. So the place is still there. You still like it, but now you heard of coronavirus. So where is your mood? Your mood is all is taken up with fear rather than all these excitement and enjoyment of, oh, this is where I'm going to go. So that means, imagine in this totally constantly changing world, it's set up like this, right? All three are changing and we are searching for lasting fulfillment. It is not possible. Chira.
So I agree, everything is changing and so are we. And so
yes.
On one point of our karma,
yes.
We come to a slightly higher level and then
yes.
We are like, okay, now we can do better from here.
Yes.
So there's this constant change, right?
Yes.
You know, change is the only constant kind of concept, right?
Yes.
I don't know what permanent fulfillment is.
Okay.
So am I actually gunning for it? Because what does that mean?
Okay.
Does that
so, that
mean
means, so what it means, Chirag, is that no matter how, this is a what we call a human program. A human program is, you can't erase from human program that I want fulfillment. You can't. That you want free, you want to be free from lack and limitation. You can't totally eliminate it.
So that means,
that's why we keep going here.
So this change is improvement for us, right? We keep trying to solve something to achieve a level of fulfillment.
Yes.
But where is it permanent?
Okay.
I don't understand.
So exactly. So this is why, what Vedanta is saying is, this is a good point. This, Vedanta doesn't say it's bad or anything, that you should not be here. But it says that this cannot solve your problem of this.
Correct.
So that means you have to, only when you recognize this, and if there is a question that, okay, where do I find this, then this I can continue to pursue, it's not opposed to this, but through this I don't look for this. There must be an independent source which can get me here. This, if you start with a possibility, then there is Vedanta.
So that's just you then.
So, sorry?
Mean, so it's just you.
Yeah.
It depends on if it's your pursuit.
No, Vedanta introduces the last pursuit of moksha. This Tattva Dhyana Tadarshanam is a last pursuit of moksha. We live with only these three pursuits. And this we think is the end. And within this you keep striving and striving and striving.
Correct.
And then you think it is getting you closer to this. This is your thinking. But at one point, you have, when you recognize that actually this doesn't actually, sometimes takes you closer, sometimes even takes you farther. So what happens is, see, if it was only progressively taking you closer, then you can still have a hope that, okay, now more of this. But actually, what ends up happening is, that not only this doesn't get you here, but because this whole world is set up in a way that is constantly changing, you get further loads. Loads of anxiety.
Changing.
So you get anxiety. And this is how, and anybody who denies it, is not, and then you have some sorrows. Then you have fears. Then you have sometimes inferiority. So that means, not only it is like progressively taking you closer and closer, it sometimes actually brings you totally opposite to what you are really looking for. So therefore, you cannot say that, okay, now if I go here, it will take me that much closer to this goal. That's not true. What you want from life is one thing. What ends up happening is something quite different. Only when you clearly understand that, right? Then you can say there must be some other solution, out of the box solution. To this, which is common to everyone and nobody can erase it. So suppose there are great thinkers like what is this famous existentialist?
Swami.
No, Swami. This very famous existentialist Jean-Paul Sartre. Jean-Paul Sartre is a great French philosopher, and he sees this very clearly. He says you can't get this from what you are searching for is this. You can't get it from here. Not only you can't get it, but it actually takes you on a completely different, quite opposite of what you are searching for. So then he says,
major people are only in that circle.
Yeah, but suppose you recognize that and you conclude that there is no solution now.
Correct.
Then what will happen? You'll be depressed.
So Sartre, what is his version of the solution?
So his version is, this is how the world is. So we can't find what we are searching for.
We haven't got this.
They haven't got this.
That's
a very
dejected. Oh, there's nothing now.
It's very defeating because that is an innate human search that all of us have come with. And we do things, and as Chirag said, we do it and we say that, yeah, right now it is not there, but little more will get me there. But he sees very clearly that actually you'll never get there, and not only that, you will have this. So that means now, and then there is no solution. It is sad. This is why all these French people, they are great thinkers, but suppose you subscribe to this view of life, they all get depressed.
The fundamental problem is only not understood.
So that means,
circling in
the the solution to this fundamental problem is not there for them. Because there is no solution, therefore it is depressing. So that means a human being is caught in a no-win situation. So that is that, right? So what Vedanta says is it can't be so gloomy. There has to be a solution, but the solution is not exactly here, it's somewhere else. So that is the Tattva Jnana Tadarshana. So therefore, then the question is...
One minute, I'll wait for it.
Is it okay? Now, the question is, I can't give up this search, so where is it? So what Vedanta is saying is, this is all last value that we saw, and now, then after this we come to today's value. The only possibility, only logical possibility, okay? So what I want to be free from limitation. All these other things can be defined as free from limitation. This is almost like mathematics. What is my starting point about me? I'm small. Small is, it means limited. Limited in time, limited in place, limited in knowledge, limited in my power to influence things. This is how it is, no matter how powerful I am. But I can't, get coronavirus to stop. I am limited, right? So this is what is meant by limitation. Okay. Now, I engage in the world and through objects. Objects themselves are limited. So when will limited plus limited add up to freedom from limitation?
With knowledge.
So now, limited plus limited, can it lead to freedom from limitation? It's impossible. This will never add up here. This is a fact. This is logical fact. So that means then the only possibility for this search, which I cannot erase, is that objects are limited, I cannot change. Everything is within time, space, and it is limited. I can't change that. The only possibility is maybe my starting point that I am small is not totally true. This is the only logical possibility to come out of this problem. So that means maybe I'm not limited, maybe I am
much more than what I think I am. Like, suppose a whale who takes whaleness as its final reality is told that, hey, essentially you are water. Is it something in the imagination? Is it something make-believe? Suppose the wave shifts its essential identity from wave to water. What happens? Immediately,
it expands
to the whole ocean. Do you understand? Does it have to do anything? It is just a change of perspective. It's a change of perspective which is based on reality. It is not some make-believe. Somebody is trying to make you kind of, you know, put you in some delusion that you are free from limitation. This is, it is true, but we still keep missing it.
Uma?
Yes.
And on the flip side, so you are everything, but you are also nothing in the process.
So you are not this individuality.
Yes.
Exactly. So, essentially, but actually, we are not totally trying to negate this individuality. Then what happens is you start kind of living in some fantasy world that I'm only water. So what we are trying to do is we retain our wave. Wave is there. Nobody can deny it. What we are trying to do is bring something more fundamental. We are without negating the wave. Bring something more fundamental, which is really more fundamental. And by doing this, what happens that this is everywhere. This, we free ourselves from, by bringing from this to this, without giving up this, we just add one more perspective. By doing that, does water have mortality? Wave comes and goes. Does the water come and go in the ocean, in the example of the ocean? No. Wave has a location. Does water have a location? So that means the shift, the paradigm shift is huge. You understand? So that means it has a huge implication. But that doesn't mean that you are trying to deny the wave. Yes. Right now, I'm a wave, but my essential reality is water. And that is the essential reality of not only me, but all the other waves and also the entire ocean. Suppose there is this truth about you, the individual. There is a more fundamental truth. And suppose you don't know that. So your whole life is lived with this being your final identity. And you're totally oblivious to this more fundamental reality, then life is lived as somebody who is small. And this program that you want to free yourself from limitation cannot be erased because the life wants to take you to this reality of yours. And you keep searching for this through artha, dharma and kama. This, and is trying to be free, it's not possible. So what Vedanta teaches is, only when you get to know this, then there will be a final fulfillment. But that doesn't mean that you will give it up. Unfortunately, people think that once you know that you are water, what is there to do? No, you will continue to do this, but with a proper perspective. Through this, you're not trying to complete yourself, but for your engagement while you are an individual in the world is necessary. Why? Because the world is organized in a way that we are all interconnected. So therefore, what I do has implication on so many others. And suppose I don't do what I have to do, then I disturb the whole harmony of the world, whether I recognize. So that means now, because I don't have a pressure to, through this, I want to become big, because I do understand a much more fundamental reality. In fact, I engage in all this with a lot more freedom.
As I engage in all of this with a lot more freedom, actually my participation here becomes better.
So water, the waves reality is that it is a part of water. Or it is water.
In fact, it is water.
Yeah.
It is not part of water.
What is our reality?
So your reality is this, the next verse. So the next verse. What we are trying to say is, why do you even want to know your reality? Why do you want to even get there? Right now we haven't come to what is this reality. Right now this value is, why do you want to know this? How does it apply to you? Why should you be interested in knowing this? Do you understand?
Fundamental problem has to be understood.
Exactly. The fundamental problem has to be intimately understood, and where does the solution lie, that also has to be clear. Because if you don't have that clarity, you will not pursue Vedanta. Why should you pursue Vedanta?
The world is a constant flux of changes. So if you are just in that
room. That you are in there, exactly.
90-85%
people. People are like that. But they are still thinking that somehow they are getting closer. This is why. And they continue.
Keep
only
so
when you recognize that, hey, not necessarily you're getting closer, sometimes you're even getting farther.
It's called air freshener.
Then you said, okay, but now this is something that I can't erase this goal. There must be some other solution. Let me at least look into it. You don't need to totally subscribe to it, but at least your mind is, okay, let me at least listen to what Vedanta has to say. That particular disposition, that you are open enough to at least listen, is called Shraddha. You have not concluded that there is, how can there be any other pursuit? Only this and that's it. If you are closed, Vedanta will not make sense to you. When you are open to the possibility that maybe there is some other solution, and what Vedanta is saying is that this oneness is my understanding, which is not totally false. Right? Wave, when it understands itself as wave, is not totally false, but it's not totally right also, because there is a given relationship between wave and water. The relationship is, while wave cannot exist without being a water, water is independent of being a wave. This is the truth. And suppose you understand your reality to be something much larger, which Vedanta is going to show, then maybe you don't, this has gone away, and you live with limited objects with freedom. It's not like you don't have to engage, but through this you don't need to satisfy this. In fact, it gives you a lot more freedom. And this is how whole Bhagavad Gita is. Lord Krishna knows the reality, and he's teaching Arjuna the reality. But how is he engaging in the world? He's a king. He's king of Dwarika. He's constantly engaged. Every second he has to make big, big decisions. And he has to do what he has to do. And his mind is always totally clear, so that he is able to respond to the situations with the best perspective that is possible. There is no loss of perspective. So that means knowing this reality will give us so much freedom to deal with this world in a proper manner. Okay. So this is what is the role of moksha. So now, the next one, do you logically understand what Vedanta is trying to say? He's trying to show something more fundamental about you, which will solve this problem. And it will then not create a dependency on the limited world for your this. You can actually engage in this with freedom, because this problem is solved here. Is it clear?
Yeah. Right.
Now, the next value, which is
Excellent.
So let's take Nirmala's example. Excellent. What difference does it make? So let's take Nirmala's example. Suppose you know this reality. And suppose you have to go through difficult situation, what difference does it make whether you know this reality or you don't know this reality? That's an amazing question. It's a nice question. So let's analyze this.
Where is the restaurant here?
Okay, let's take Arjuna and Krishna. For the time being, we take what difference does it make? This is to answer that question. Suppose you know something more fundamental about it. How will it change anything when you have to face a difficult situation? So, let's take that both Arjuna and Lord Krishna were in the same situation. Where, I mean, of course, Arjuna, who represents the person who doesn't know this final reality of oneself. So he is not wise. Wise, not that he is not wise, but he doesn't know this final reality. And Krishna is the one who knows this final reality. So this is my important advice. Okay? They both are at the battlefield. When they had to fight a huge war of Mahabharata. Right? Now, how Arjuna, even though he was a very evolved human being, but because he did not know this reality, what did he, when he had to fight, what did he go through?
He didn't want to fight.
He was first overwhelmed.
Overwhelmed in relative and motion speaking.
He was overwhelmed by the situation. He was very candid about how he felt. He says, what, my throat is drying up, my mind is not able to think clearly, my hands are shaking, I'm not even able to hold this Gandiva properly. So that means he was shattered. And then he says, my God, then he analyzed, even in that state, he did analyze and saw something beyond his sorrow. And he says, not only what, my I have to kill my brothers and my teachers and my grandfather, but also there is going to be mass destruction. A lot of people are going to die. And then the society after the war is going to be dysfunctional. And then finally, if I cause so much disturbance, then what will be the consequences for me? This is the perspective of the person like Arjuna, who is really brilliant. At the same time, he doesn't know this final reality. Right? Now, Lord Krishna, suppose you take him as the person who knows this final reality. How does he behave? One would think that he would say, if you know final reality that all of us are one, he would say, now go and hug your cousin and forget about everything. But that's not what Lord Krishna is saying. What is he saying? How does he see the situation? What is his perspective? This will give you an answer to what will change when you move from here to here. Practically, what will change?
You can think objectively.
So the thing is, the same situation which brings, this is not wrong, please understand, this is a very evolved human being looking at the situation, right? So please don't think that he was all totally confused, he was not. The same situation, now he asks Lord Krishna, from this point, he asks Lord Krishna, two questions. At this point, he says, oh my God, all my accomplishments, my princely birth, my lovely family, is it taking me closer to the fulfillment? That whole thing that I'm going closer itself was shattered. Do you understand? So this is why he says, but my God, what will give me?
How is this going to give me?
Even if I win the war, and suppose even if I get the whole kingdom, how is this going to give me the fulfillment? So that means this whole thing that I'm getting closer was shattered. The second thing is, so fulfillment became a huge question for him, and in spite of analyzing the situation so well, he asked Lord Krishna, is this the right way to think about this situation, or there is some other way to think about that situation which is wiser? So he asks two questions: what will lead to fulfillment, and what should I do in this situation? Now, Lord Krishna was also seeing everything. He was seeing that there would be mass destruction. He was seeing that the society will be all dysfunctional. He was seeing all of this, that his brothers and his teachers and his grandfather was fighting. He saw all of that. Was he overwhelmed? He was not overwhelmed. But does it mean he was not overwhelmed? Does it mean that he was indifferent? No. If he was totally indifferent, he would not have offered himself and said, I will go and negotiate with Duryodhana. And I'm willing to give up almost everything and just settle for one house in order to avoid this mass destruction. You understand? It's not like he didn't care because he knew the final reality. Please don't romanticize this knowledge. This is an amazingly intricate knowledge.
It's like you're making choices at every stage and
exactly.
Giving possibilities and trying to explore that potential,
super.
But then it doesn't explode, so you move to the next.
Super. Without carrying all these loads.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And with active engagement.
First, he offers himself, right? That, yeah, okay, let's avoid it. Of course, I'm with you. I'm not pretending, oh yeah, nobody's going to die, I know this final reality. That is some crazy delusional state. It's not knowledge. So he offers himself to till the extent that, okay, let's avoid. But now, since Duryodhana doesn't accept any of this, he's not overwhelmed. He keeps his calm. And he actually tells he sees the situation very, very differently. As far as what he should do, it's a completely... as a result of all of this, Arjuna's answer was, I don't want to fight. This is where. But Lord Krishna's answer was, you must engage. You must engage in this war because it is... not for your ambition, not for your gratification, but because it is required. Any decision that we make has to pass two criteria. What are the two criteria that it has to pass?
Swadharma
and Samadhi-dharma. Samadhi-dharma. Arjuna was sticking to Samanya Dharma, which is, I don't want to cause so much violence. So he was for non-violence. Which seems like a universal value. What does Lord Krishna do? Lord Krishna adds a nuance to this value of non-violence. He says, it is true that this is a universal value. Of course it's a universal value. But suppose there is a scenario that you are non-violent, but somebody is violent towards you. Then what do you do? You just stick to, I want to be non-violent, and let that person beat you up to death. That's not called dharma. Why? Because swadharma starts with the understanding, who comes first, just as I don't want to be violated. I also understand others don't want to be subject to violence. So that means if I'm allowing unconditionally to somebody else to violate me, I'm against
samanyata. It is paradoxical.
We generally think that we have to stick to these values forever.
What Lord Krishna is saying is, yes, this is a universal value, but it is subject to interpretation.
It is subject to interpretation when somebody is constantly violating you and you're standing up for yourself is not called deviating from a non-violence. It is called the right interpretation of the value of non-violence. So that means, so Samanya Dharma, what he does is, Arjuna also had this universal value, but his understanding of universal value was not complete. Lord Krishna completes that understanding by saying that standing for yourself, when somebody else is violating you, is not considered to be against dharma. Then, with reference to swadharma, Arjuna was confused. He was confused. Why was he confused? Because there was a conflict. What kind of a conflict? Exactly. There are a conflict between two roles. One is his role as a brother, his role as a student to a teacher, his role as grandson to a grandfather, and his role as a prince. Who was a leader? Who was highly skilled? Who had some obligation towards his whole kingdom?
He's a warrior.
He's a warrior. And not just a simple warrior. He's a leader. Highest warrior. Now, there, what was he tending towards? What was taking over? His personal thing. He reminds him what this is his way of looking at his swadharma, which is not good, right? Because Duryodhana's swadharma was only, I want the kingdom and at any cost I'm going to go for this kingdom and I forget about everything else. His swadharma was far more evolved, but still not complete. Lord Krishna tells him, this is true, I totally understand this, but you also have this role. Please don't forget that. And this role, what you're going to do here, is going to have repercussions on the whole kingdom. So many people. And only for this, if you're constantly skewing everything, right, and not do this, you will bring about big confusion in the society. So therefore, the way he looked at situation, because he has a much deeper knowledge, even in that situation, his thing was totally different. How he looked at the situation, what he asked Arjuna to do was completely different. So that means understanding of Samanya Dharma is more refined. Understanding of Swadharma is more refined. And then this question of that, okay, no matter what I do, suppose I find the more understanding the fact that non-violence is, I'm not violating, I'm not going against the value of non-violence. I'm doing my Swadharma because this is my larger responsibility. And I can't just kind of be totally colored by my love for them. So suppose I do it, still will it give me fulfillment? It still will not give you fulfillment. So what is the answer to that, knowing the nature of? So he also teaches Arjuna what the nature of Atma is. So that means Lord Krishna's vision of this situation is complete. Arjuna, even though he is highly evolved, his vision of reality is restricted. And because his vision of reality is restricted, his decision, even though he's noble, it's all skewed.
So is it in that case, her buddhi was brushed and by this emotions are taken over.
Exactly. Here there was confusion. There was confusion about what will bring me final fulfillment. His emotions were all over the place.
The clarity of thinking was.
So that makes sense. So this is what, if you ask yourself, what practically knowledge will do for you? It will take you from closer. Suppose you are an evolved human being like Arjuna. It will take you closer from being Arjuna to. All the intricacies within intricacies is just mind-boggling. So that means this is, so that what? Tattva Adhyatma Jnana Nityatvam is this value. So what is this Adhyatma Jnana Nityatvam? So,
to answer Nirmala, we answer Nirmala's question, that it
is going to take you closer from being Arjuna to closer to being Arjuna, to Krishna. Really? And this is a possibility for everyone. This is Gita. It's not like we only go on praising Krishna as some great guy and he has all the wisdom. Well, Lord Krishna is saying you can become like this is Gita. So therefore, then? Suppose now I want to little bit question that final thing. What is my true nature? Am I really small or am I something bigger? How will you come to know this? Suppose this was a reality. The wave had a reality of it being water. But suppose wave was given only the eyes, suppose in this example. And with the eyes, the wave could only see other waves. How will the wave ever come to know the fact that actually everything is water? On its own, can it figure it out? Because the eyes can only see other forms. So the content of all the forms, suppose it's not available to you, then how will you ever know it? So this is why this second value. What is the second value? Adhyatma Jnana Nityatva. That the fundamental problem that you are trying to solve, which will give you the right perspective with reference to everything. How will you come to know this reality? Suppose you were not small, and suppose you were free from being small, and you were equivalent to water, which has no limitation, free from limitation. How will you get from here to here? By magic. So this is where he says that the wave being water is really a fact. So that means wave doesn't need to do anything, it only needs knowledge of a more fundamental reality without negating its bigness. How do you get knowledge? So he gives in this para, he says, suppose you sit under a tree or you go to Himalaya, will it just kind of dawn on you that I'm not small and I'm big? It's impossible. It's impossible because you're caught in a given paradigm. Unless somebody shows it to you, how will you ever shift from that paradigm?
Even if you all have that contemplative.
So, no, even if you have contemplative mind, what will you do? The your self identity is not going to change.
So you are engaged with other people or see someone smarter or better.
Exactly. Any knowledge, please, he introduces a very, very big thing. Adhyatma Jnana. Jnana means no knowledge, he says, can be, no matter how nice you are as a human being, no knowledge can be gained without an appropriate means of knowledge. If you want to gain knowledge, you need to look for means of knowledge. What does it mean? He gives an example in this book that suppose you are a very nice person and you want to understand black holes, suppose, right? Now you're good, you're really nice. Now you say, okay, I'm so nice, so I'm going to sit under a Bodhi tree or I'm going to go to Himalayas and the knowledge of black holes will just dawn on me. Will it?
No.
Do you understand? Any knowledge, whether it is economics or it is physics or it is biology, requires an appropriate means of knowledge. Without appropriate means of knowledge, you can never acquire knowledge. So that means this fantasy that we have, that somehow I just have to be a good human being and I'll sit in meditation and my nature, which is my more fundamental nature, will just emerge like that.
You know, a lot of books say that, right? That yes. The mountains for 15 super. Years and it came
exactly.
Back.
There are so many books. I went to the mountain and somehow it dawned on me and now I'm enlightened. This is all humbug, according to this tradition. No knowledge can take place without an appropriate means of knowledge. And it's not something which is unique to Vedanta. It is not true for everything.
So you have to seek mediums.
So you have to seek then appropriate means of knowledge. So what we say is, what is this book saying is, that suppose you want to see eyes, to see a form, what is the means of knowledge that you need?
Eyes. Yeah.
Right? So that means you want a knowledge of a form. Can you just say, today I want to use my ears for a change? It's impossible. Well, can you say, oh, I go under and sit under Himalaya and then this form will just somehow emerge? No. Knowledge requires an appropriate means of knowledge. For form it is eyes. For sound it is ears. So that means, suppose you want to know how old is the universe. Is your perception enough? No. If you can't see how old is the universe with your perception, what you see is only some sofas and some tree and some sea. You can't come to some understanding of how old is the universe. So when scientists look at the world, right, in addition to perception, they use second means of knowledge. What is the second means of knowledge? Inference. Inference means logically moving from. They do yes. Some observation.
When you see a smoke, you know it's a fire.
Exactly. So that means this is a one-step inference that Viresh is talking about. You see smoke and you infer that there is fire. Mm-hmm. But in order to have an advanced inference, like how old is the universe? So now they say it's 13.5 billion old years old universe. So now how did you come to that? Not one simple inference. Series of inferences. They make some observations and series of tight logical steps to arrive at that conclusion. So we have two major means of knowledge with us. One is, this is called perception, that you do with your five senses, and the other one is inference. But both of these are about objects that you can observe, right? Even the scientists, when they infer, they have some data that they observe, and based on that they use logic in order to arrive at very advanced conclusions, not just simple conclusions. Okay, so this perception and inference is something that we use. With this, can you come to know that Atma is free from limitation? With these two things that we have with us, it's impossible. Why? Because this Atma is not an object which is observable. So that means what it shows then is, if you were to know a more fundamental reality about you, which is I, and I is not available for observation, because it is not available for observation, your normal means of knowledge, which is perception and inference, it will not do the job. So you do need an independent means of knowledge. So this is what we call words of Vedanta. What is their job? They are an independent means of knowledge to make you see some fundamental reality about you. Now, there is a, do I have 5 minutes? Is it okay? Okay. Now, suppose this is interesting, because suppose I say, mind is an independent means of knowledge which can never be arrived at by perception and inference. There is a possibility I'll tell you any cock and bull story. And then I'll say that it's an independent means of knowledge. So you can't verify with perception and inference. And I'll tell you anything that I want. Do you understand? The minute I declare it as an independent means of knowledge, I run into this problem. This is why whole of spiritual world, they will just tell you anything that they want. Energies are cleansing this and all, because you don't have any logical way to either prove or disprove it. And they will say, anyway, it's not available for logic. So you are in their hands and they can do what they want with you. This is whole Baba world. So that means, what Vedanta says is, for something to be a valid means of knowledge, it needs to meet two conditions. Two conditions. What is the first condition? It has to give you knowledge about something that other means of knowledge cannot give. So that means, and second is, it is irrefutable. What does it mean? Nobody can logically refute what you are saying. So that means, even if a quantum physicist is sitting in the class, and if the Vedanta teacher is teaching properly, the quantum physicist may or may not agree because they have their own way, methods, they have their observation and all that. But he cannot find a logical argument to say this is implausible. They won't have that. So that is what we call that if what it says is valid, it is logically irrefutable. This is what makes the study of Vedanta another week altogether. Another week because suppose and logically irrefutable means I don't make one statement, you are the whole. I have to show you step by step. How is it so? And each step cannot be logically refuted. So that means this is your wanting to engage with Vedanta will come by understanding all that I explained in this class earlier. You need to know what you are looking for. You need to know something else cannot give you what you are looking for. You need to know the only solution is that this is my starting point is wrong. And then you have to see that when I change that starting point, it's not some theoretical correction. It will change the way I engage in the world. And I am willing to give it a try because it is, I can't get it through my normal means of knowledge. And what Vedanta is saying is logically refuted. So until I can logically refute it, why not listen to it? I can listen to it because it's telling me something that I want to be. I want to be free from limitations. I want to be. And it starts by saying, hey, you are, and let me show you how. So this is, when you see this, then adhyatma jnana vidyato. So you need to invest in this knowledge, which is of this nature, and at least hear what it has to say.
The means of this knowledge, like you said, the means of that form is your eyes.
Yes.
Right? Is finding a good teacher.
So the teacher, but teacher himself got it from the body of knowledge. So this body of knowledge is not belonging to any person. So that is, it is Vedanta. So it is, that is why he says it is contained in Upanishads. In this book, he says it's contained in. So Upanishads have a value because they are not just making the statement that fundamentally you are free. It is showing you logically how it is. Two step by step.
So I have a big fundamental problem. My wife wants to believe that everything she says is logically irrefutable.
So then it's very easy. Rajiv, it's very easy. You find the logic which will refute it. That's easy.
This is merit, right?
Okay, I'm sitting on it.
Okay, I'll do the Purna Mada prayer. Yeah, I'll just do
it. But there are duplicates, so you'll just take out the ones you have.